that rough.
Thank you.
2023, Idaho Falls, Idaho. Funeral service is 11 a.m. Saturday, September 16th, 2023, in the Coleman Ward, Idaho Falls, Idaho. The family prayer was given by Brother Tim Butikofer. Bishop Jay Schreeder is officiating. Our prelude and postlude music today is by Candy Clay. Chorister, Billy Joel Butikofer. How Great Thou Art, Congregational Hymn, Hymn 86. The invocation will be given by Brian Taylor. Life Sketch by Amy Crump. Musical number You'll Never Walk Alone, Terry Bryan, vocalist. Memories by Matt Butikofer. Oh My Father, Tess Roberts, a violinist. Spiritual Thought, we give him my brother by Tim Butikofer. Closing Remarks by Bishop Jay Schreeder. I Am a Child of God, Grandchildren and Great-Grandchildren of Arlen. Benediction will be by Jan Taylor. The interment will be at the Grant Cemetery, Rigby, Idaho. Dedicatory prayer will be given by Matt Butikofer. And military rites by the Bonneville County Veterans and Idaho Honor Guard. Pallbearers are Matthew Butikofer, Drew Bryan, Benjamin Taylor, Timothy Butikofer, Joshua Taylor, Brian Taylor, Kendall Bryan, Michael Taylor, Douglas Crump. Honorary pallbearers, Bodie Butikofer, Jason Hagen, Miles Carroll, Taylor Knapp, Caleb Butikofer, Ted Miller, David Schmidt, Luke Taylor, Kalel Thuison, Larry Butikofer, Brad Crump. A friend of all the treasures one can find until his life has reached its end, there really isn't anything of greater value than a friend. A friend is all you'll ever need when times of crisis are at hand and you are looking all about for someone who will understand. And in darkness you can see, it helps a lot to have a friend who at your side right there can be. Or if you feel a loneliness that simply will not go away, it's wonderful to have a friend to bring you smiles across the day. I know it would be hard for me without a loyal friend or two, especially the kind of friend that I have always found in you. Anonymous. The family of Arlen Butikofer wishes to express their gratitude for your kindness in both thoughts and deed. How Great Thou Art, Hymn 86.
Consider all as we come at this funeral for Arlen Butikofer, that thy spirit will be with us and be with the family and his kids and extended family, and that they will know that he is with them in this time. We pray that those that are speaking this day, and that they will have his spirit with them, and that thy spirit with them also. And that as people have traveled in distances to be here, that they will be safe as they have plans to return home. We are thankful for thy Son, the atonement that it gives to us, and to be able to return back to thee and to see Arlen again in the future. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
To John and Ethel Butikofer. He is one of five siblings, his brother Larry, and his sisters Maxine, Levita, and Lois. When Dad was a boy, he had some chores. They were milking the cows, getting the wood, and getting coal for the house. One night, those were his nightly chores. One night, he thought he'd be really smart and he didn't fill the wood box. Grandpa John got up at 5 o'clock every morning, so Dad thought that Grandpa John would fill it. Grandpa John went down and got Dad at 5 o'clock in the morning, making him come up and fill the wood box, so he never did that again. He served a mission in Canada and was drafted into the Army and was stationed at Fort Ord, California. He served as a chaplain's assistant, a cook, and a unit clerk. He went into the reserves and came home and met our selfless, incredible mom. He and Mom owned several businesses, the Sinclair gas station and store in Arco, the Butikofer OLX oil distribution plant in Blackfoot. Dad drove truck for Challenger Pallet in Idaho Falls and worked for the church, but farming is what he loved. At a young age, he knew that's what he wanted to do with his life. He loved farming the family farm. He believed deeply in donating blood and was dedicated to it. If I ever needed a mechanic or a plumber, Dad was there. He could pretty much do anything. If it was broke, he could fix it. Sometimes with some pretty choice words, but it was When I was little, we would butcher our cows, and my dad would pick up the cow's tongue. Most people find that pretty gross. But my dad and I would make sandwiches. We'd take mayo and slice up the cow's tongue and put it on there. It was pretty good. I must be my dad's daughter, because when I go shopping, I have to buy two of everything. So I have a backup. Well, my dad would buy a backup for the backup. It was crazy. When I was still taking the bottle, we'd go to Mexico. I was crying, my bottle was sour, and I guess that was me. My dad decided I'd be drinking from the bottle because we had to drop the window, and that was all there was. Dad is flirted with death several times in his life. Just a few of them are. He fell through the ice, and there was swift water running through it. Can't remember how he got out. But if he had gone under, he wouldn't have come back out. When he was flying with the tractor, it came in contact with the high power lines and the tire mounts. He jumped, but he got out. Apparently, when you're in open fields, you can get snowmobiles up to about 60 miles an hour. He came up upon a barbed wire fence about 150 feet ahead of him. He managed to drag his feet and stop within 3 feet of the fence, but if he hadn't, it would have just another ride, he saw a coyote way off in the fields. He headed straight for that coyote. At one point, things looked a little different, felt a little different, but he didn't know quite what it was. He broke, drug his feet, and stopped. And he looked out, and he was on top side of a 50-foot drop. He skated on the snow machine and fell back and managed to avoid going over. In 2007, he was outside of a cement barrel, pinned him down, and he hurt his like legs and his arms and his hip and stuff, and had the phone in his phone, and obviously police called for 911. When he was boating at John Holt's Bridge, he was on a two-seater speedboat that went really fast. It stalled, and a cattle cruiser came by. Dad was sitting on the back of the seat and the waves threw him out. The boat went one way and Dad went the other. He was holding on with his finger and the weight of the water, my dad was pulling his finger, so it tore off his finger. He lost his finger. The cabin crew who came back towed Dad to the dock and they went to the hospital and we took a graft out of his leg to go for his finger. The last 4 months he found out he had leukemia and he chose to fight it. He was a fighter till the end. Dad lived on his own terms. He was a hard man at times, but he gave all he could. He taught us some good things and some bad things. He loved his neighbors. He made some lifelong friends, and he would do what he could do to help them all. Some other things for Dad. He loved the snow machine. One of his happiest moments was when he won the snowmobile race in Idaho Park, the 101. He was a member of a team of three, and all of them had to cross the finish line. One of his team members' sleds broke down, and Dad and all three had to cross it to win. So Dad and his teammate hooked onto the sled and drove as fast as he could to pulling it across the finish line, and they won that race. Dad loved to catch skunks. One time he thought he would drown it in the water trough, which he did, but the cows wouldn't go near it for a really long time. Another time Mom and Dad were coming home from a dance. It was like a dress and a suit affair. The car turned in the driveway, light swept over the yard. A black and white animal was waddling across the lawn. Dad followed the skunk and Mom ran for the gun. The skunk disappeared into a cement culvert. Dad stood ground until Mom brought the gun and the flashlight back. Dad pointed the gun and the flashlight at the opening. He told Mom to pull up the tin shield around my head. As the shield was lifted, a yellow stream of skunk oil followed the shaft of the light to the gun instantaneously and the bullet was fired. Dad sights up the stream, but the skunk was dead, but the smell was fine. Dad liked to go boating. He would often take the boat out. He was a skilled water skier. He could swallow with the best of them. He also loved to do all kinds of fishing, whether it was ice fishing on the lake or the river. He loved hunting and was usually successful. A few years back, Dad had a small drift boat, and he had it in the back of his pickup. And he was coming fishing with us, my husband and I, Doug, for his maiden voyage. And it was in the back of his truck, and so when he went to get it off the truck, he tapped on the brakes and just slid right out of the back of the truck. Doug was already in the water, so he could go get it and get it paddled back up. I was videotaping the whole thing. One of Dad's favorite things was to come to Irwin. Doug and I have some property in Irwin, and we have our camper, and he had a deck out there, and Dad would sit on this one corner of our deck, and he just loved to come up and sit and visit for hours. My son Bodhi couldn't be here, but Dad would take him to my lake and they would go fishing. And Bodhi loved his grandpa and all the time he got to spend with my dad. Dad's had 88 years of adventure, excitement, mistakes, and successes. 5 pretty awesome and good-looking kids. He helped us decide who we wanted to be and shaped us into what we are. Our family would like to thank you all for coming and showing your love and support for my dad. Thank you to all those that visited him and helped him along the way. We are thankful. We are a family. We love you, Dad.
Dad asked me to sing this, I don't know, it must have been 8 or 10 or something, way back. And he would always tell me that I needed to sing the song he's been on. And I don't know if I can, but we're going to give it a shot.
Well, hello everyone. Oh, I forgot something. Hang on. It's really hard to find a family where they're all proper, you know, and I'm just not. I'm the irreverent one, and I'm good with that. When I was a kid, I was in this chapel, and a lot of things have changed. But I remember the very first talk I ever gave here, I wanted so bad to run out.
I remember being just a kid thinking, you know what? If I run out that door, I only have this much shame. And then after that, I'm great. But I decided to stick around. So I'd like to thank Terry for doing that beautiful song. And for all of you being here and supporting Dad. He's in a place now where his progression gets to continue. And that's a wonderful thing. And it's no news to you guys. It's going to happen to every one of us. We're going to be in the same spot. And our progression is going to be able to continue. And that's a wonderful gift our Heavenly Father has given to us. A couple things I'd like to tell you. Dad didn't graduate from the Ammon High School. His classmates were here today, and they told me that he graduated from Bonneville High School, which is actually downtown Ammon, and it was a two-story school. The second thing is, I would like to ask Doug Butikofer to come up and be a pallbearer with the rest of us. He's going to do that. We're keeping this to an hour, so I have to be brief. Dad had a lot of experiences in his life that were really enjoyable for him to be around. Tad Hextead is here, and his father and my father had quite a link. I'll tell you about his dad really quick. One day we're rolling up County Line Road, and we get up there, and there's this guy stopped right in the middle of the road, and he's got a pickup truck, and he's got pallets stacked as high as he can go. I don't know how he threw pallets that high, and he needed to get them strapped down. And Dad and I happened to be going the same way, so we stopped and helped him when his dad was first starting the business that you guys now have. He was a wonderful man. My dad had an experience when the Teton Dam broke to actually sit through the flood with Vic Hextead on the top of their house. Dad and Vic were that good of friends that during that process, Dad just couldn't let Vic sit there alone. They wrapped the whole house in plastic as well as Vic's mom's house. They took the semi-trailers up. And Vic went and sat on his house, and Dad said, well, if you're going to sit here, Vic, I'm going to sit right here with you. So they'd bring him lunch, they'd bring him breakfast, and he just sat there the whole time. I don't know what they were thinking. Maybe they were thinking, if the water took the house, they'd have a ride. I don't know what they were thinking, but I remember as a kid, I was on duty at the farmhouse. I was sitting in the camper, and I had to watch and make sure water didn't get on the dike, but those two sat. Sharon Nixon is here, and later on, when her husband Ralph was struggling, Dad would take time and he would go down and actually read to Ralph. Dad had a way of helping people in certain ways that he knew really helped them. And I think along the way, it helped him as well. And so those are things. He had a charging nature. There's nobody here that hasn't experienced that. We know that. With that charging nature, he had the passion to do things that made him who he was. And we've all got the same passion. And the grandkids and the great-grandkids. So the passion is good. Take that passion and use it for good. The other stuff that's not so good, figure out how to deal with that in your own way. But the passion, take the passion for doing well and doing good and loving people and helping people. That's the kind of passion I take from my dad. Because that's the passion he showed me. Couple stories I want to tell you about in the night gallery. There's one person here who's probably the oldest living one of Dad's friends he used to hunt and fish with. He wrote him a poem, and I want to read that to you in a bit. But a couple stories. There was a guy in the war, his name was Brother Bybee. And Larry, if I get this wrong, will you please correct me? Because you know a lot of things too. I got another story to tell him. Everybody else is perished but you, so you might want to set me straight on that story too. Anyway, so Brother Bybee, he was a family that my dad was called home teach. And so the first time he went to their house, knocked on Brother Bybee's house, he could hear a radio playing, but Brother Bybee wasn't anywhere to be found. So Dad knocked on the door, nobody was there, and he left. He and his companion came back the second month, same thing. Everything's open, the screen doors are open, knocked on the door, and radio playing, no Brother Bybee. Well, Brother Bybee was kind of like Dad in his later years. He didn't go a lot of places. He just kind of hung out there. So Dad decided to go on a mission. So he walked around the place to see where he was. Well, Brother Bybee was sitting on a haystack. And Dad said, hello. And Brother Bybee couldn't see really well. He was a little bit blind, but Dad introduced himself and his companion and told him he was there to home teach. And I don't think Brother Bybee said a word the first time. Didn't say hi, didn't say goodbye, didn't say anything. So Dad told him who he was and asked him if he needed any help, and he left. The next month he came back, more of the same. Next month, more of the same. And then Dad would come a little more often, more of the same. Every time Dad would knock on the door, Brother Bybee would go out the back door and go sit in on his haystack. As time went on, they developed a friendship. And one day when Dad decided to go home teaching, he knocked on the door. Brother Bybee actually came to the door. Didn't let Dad in, but they actually had some sort of conversation. As it continued, and his dad and his companion, sometimes we don't always take our companions because life gets busy, but Dad and Brother Bybee developed a very strong friendship that lasted many, many years until Brother Bybee finally passed away. And it was something that through Dad's persistence, and because he loved people, he chose to continue to knock on the door. And that isn't always an easy thing. We all have an opportunity to do ministry, and sometimes it's hard to keep going back when you don't feel welcome. But Dad did go back. And because of that, he gained a great friend. Because of that, Brother Bybee had somebody he could rely on. Because later on, doctor's appointments and different things, Dad had an opportunity to take those. Dad was a snowmobiler, and he used to snowmobile with Al Harvey and Larry Jacobs and, gosh, Brother Quinn, I can't think of his first name, and John Quinn. And so there was all these people they snowmobiled with. And one day they decided to go snowmobiling out at Monida, which is Spencer, which is North Water Falls. And like always, whenever you're snowmobiling, and I have to tell you a little story for that. I used to snowmobile too. I started snowmobiling when I was about 10. And we would snowmobile with these same guys. And we'd unload at a place called Burn Siding, which is up above Heising. We'd go on these rides. Well, I wasn't at all of the caliber these guys were riding. So we'd unload and we'd get going, and they'd just take off and they'd leave me. And I'd be like, huh. So I just followed the tracks. And about every hour I'd see Dad, who had a red snowmobile, it was a red rod, and he had a red snowmobile suit and a silver helmet. He'd make this great big circle, and he'd come back and he'd just say, are you okay? Do you need any help? I'd say, nope, good. Off he was again. He wasn't going to stay and ride with me. He was going to ride with the big boys. And that's how I learned the snowmobile. Is every hour I get a check. Yep, I'm good. He says, just follow the tracks, you'll be fine. And that's how it ended. And I enjoyed that experience with Dad. One day he was in Monida, he was riding a snowmobile, and every once in a while you kick up a coyote. And so they were riding along and they kicked up this coyote. So they start chasing this coyote. And for the women that are here, I'm sorry, it's a little bad, we run over the coyotes. That's how you slow them down. So you run over them. Somebody else runs over them, and you keep doing that. Pretty soon, they're docile enough that you can terminate them. And so, they're doing this coyote, and they're riding on this coyote. Well, one of the snowmobilers decided that sitting on a snowmobile wasn't adequate enough. They wanted to get close to the action. So they bailed off on this coyote. Got on top of the coyote, set the coyote in the snow, had hands on both sides, the coyote's face is going like this, just going around like that. And another one of the snowmobilers named Al Harvey drove up and looked at this guy and said, so Arlen, what are you going to do now? So Dad had decided he wanted to bulldog the coyote, so he bulldogged his coyote. Well, Dad looked at Al Harvey and said, well, I was hoping that you'd reach in my coat where my .38 special is, and you'd take it out and you'd just shoot that coyote in between one of my fingers. And I said, well, that's a good thought, isn't it? Eventually, Al, after he probably had a lot of fun, took the gun out and shot the coyote. And as soon as Dad stepped off the coyote, guess what? The coyotes remained at that time. They had these chiggers and all these bugs. As soon as Dad stepped off, his whole snowmobile suit, which was red, was crawling with all these red bugs. He couldn't get out of his snowmobile suit fast enough to try to shake the bugs. And the rest of the day when they would ride it, and then they'd stop for lunch or something, LRV would say, hey, Arlen, I think that's another bug on your shoulder. So he'd have to strip everything off again and shake everything out. That was the kind of guy he was. Ted Miller was a good friend of my father. Like a lot of people were good friends of my father. And I appreciate that. Because sometimes his barometer wasn't easy to be a good friend with. That temperature went up and down. And I'm grateful for those who stayed and those who enjoyed the good sight, the wonderful sight that he had. Ted, I haven't read this, so I hope your English is good. I'm going to give it a whirl. They say, I don't know if you can see this, this is a picture. It's actually a picture of Dad sitting by a camper. I don't know whose camper it is, it's out on the ice, and he's ice fishing. They say ice fishing is one of those things that's really good for the heart. Doesn't matter if you're a happy soul or just a grumpy old fart. I see you've got a new camper. You must have kept him hidden somewhere. And the lake you're on is a secret place. You've not taken anyone else there. I bet your hut's got a propane stove to prevent unwanted icicles. And no doubt a cooler full of food, plus a gallon bottle of dill pickles. It's cheaper to buy them that way, you know, though they're heavy to lug around. I remember you took one to the Salmon River. That jug must have weighed 30 pounds. So you're just sitting there enjoying the day, just you and your fishing poles. Whether the fish are biting or not, you keep one eye on your several ice poles. Why are you keeping this all to yourself? Seems like an enjoyment never ends. It'd be real nice if you'd break down and invite a few of your friends. I know the guy in the picture is you, though you gave the photograph another name. You've done this to protect your fishing spot and to hide any claim to fame. But since you're not getting any younger, you deserve to have lots of fun. So go for it every chance you get, and don't hold back until you're done. Thanks, Ted, for writing that poem. Thanks, Ted, for being a good friend. And I thank again all of you for being a good friend of my father. I love my father. My father taught me a lot of wonderful things. Things that I don't think anybody else could have taught. I also want to tell my mother how much I love her for helping us five be who we are and be who she is still to all of the kids and all of the grandkids. I love my family very much. Everyone that's here, I appreciate you coming. I have a great testimony of the gospel and how the gospel really takes that place in our life that we need. We need the gift of the gospel. We need that spirit in our lives. We need that strength to help us get through things that are struggles. And along with that spirit, we need family. We need family who loves us, who will work right beside us, who will accept us for who we are, and help us be better. Because sometimes we need to be better. Sometimes somebody has to tell us to be better. And that's sometimes what family has to do. We have to become better. I know the gospel's true. And I'm thankful that I had a Savior that was willing to die for me and for all of us so that Dad's death and all of our deaths give us a chance for eternal progression. Whatever that looks like for each one of us and however it goes, He gives us that opportunity. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Before I leave, I want to say one other thing. Those of you who haven't had a chance to clean out your junk that are in those mature years, take the time to get it done. Seriously. Because we've got two generations. That's so much. But the main reason I'm telling you this is when we start pulling things out and you start seeing all the wonderful things, the history and the friendships and the pictures, don't hide that from your kids and your grandkids. Get it out. Let them see it. Let them see what it is. Because then you can actually tell them the story. You can actually help them understand your life. Mission. Everything that you do. Okay, that's my plug.
That's hard to follow up. Your daughter plays such a beautiful song. It's funny that Matt was talking about going out that door because I swear he taught me some other secret doors that led to HUD's Market. And the Pepsis on Sunday were so good. I just want to thank again everybody who came today and to support us as a family and remember my father and to be here today. It's so good to see everyone. It's good to be here with everybody. And man, it's a lot of memories come flooding back. I haven't been here. I left shortly after my mission and I haven't been back. And I see all of you and all so many memories come back. And it's been so fun to reminisce and think and remember about being here. And I forgot one thing about this church. And I don't want this to bring this to your attention for you that are here, because it will probably drive you crazy, but doesn't that look like a canoe? That will bug you now for the rest of your life as soon as when you come to this building. But I remember sitting there going, why is there a canoe in this church? Did they build it around it? I never understood that. But see, you're all looking at it right now. I knew it. My dad asked that I give a spiritual thought. And this time, when things like this happen in our lives, it tends to cause us to reflect a little bit about our own lives and cause us to reflect a little bit about life in general. And you're still looking at it, I can tell already. But we think about our lives and what the purpose is here. Because life is hard. There's a lot of things we strive to do the best we can, but there's a lot of toiling, there's a lot of struggles, there's sickness, there's disappointments, but there's a lot of happiness and a lot of great things in life. But it causes us to reflect a little bit. And when I reflect about life and about our purpose here, I also start to think about the plan of salvation and how important the plan of salvation is to us, so that we know what we're doing here and why we're doing what we're doing, why we're toiling so hard, why we're trying so hard. If there wasn't that plan, there would be no point. We're just here. But the plan doesn't work unless we have a Savior, unless we have Jesus Christ in our life. And Jesus Christ and His atonement in the plan of salvation. It doesn't work without Him, not even at all, not even a little bit. He plays the key role in the plan of salvation. In Doctrine and Covenants 43, this is a time when Joseph Smith was gaining some revelation because there are so many people in the church claiming that they were receiving revelation. So he was reminding everybody that only the prophets receive revelation, and then they give it to us. But at the end, the Lord told Joseph Smith, "Hearken ye to these words, behold," this is in D&C 43:34. "Hearken ye to these words. Behold, I am Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. Treasure these things up in your hearts and let the solemnities of eternity rest upon your minds." And I read that and I didn't understand what a solemnity was. So I looked it up. And a solemnity is a formal observance of an event. So let me read that again. "Hearken ye to these words. Behold, I am Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. Treasure these things up in your hearts and let the atonement of Jesus Christ of eternity rest upon your mind." That's who we need to be grateful for during these hard times, and that's who supports us and helps us through the Holy Ghost during these difficult times. But without Him, the plan of salvation has nothing, is nothing. It doesn't hold a place in our lives, but with Him, it's everything. And the knowledge that we have brings that peace and that comfort to our lives. It gives us that eternal perspective of a divine plan. In conclusion, there's one story about Jesus Christ in the book of Mark that I love. And it's when He is in the Sea of Galilee, He's on the seashore, and He is preaching, and there's so many people that they put Him on a ship, and so He goes out on the ship and He's teaching, and He teaches all day, and then He gets finished and He says, "Okay, apostles, let's go across." And you guys all know the story. So they start to go across, and there's a storm, and the waves are beating in the ship, the water's coming in, The apostles are trying to get water out, they're trying to keep the ship going, and they're just at their last hope. And where is Jesus Christ? He's sleeping on a pillow, resting. And the apostles say, "Master, do you not care that we perish?" I'm paraphrasing. And he wakes up and he extends his hand and he says, "Peace be still." And the waters were still. And then he turns to his apostles and said, "Why are you afraid? Don't you have faith?" And that's one of my favorite stories for many reasons, but number one, because that was a man who could bring peace because he had peace. And it was a man that the apostles counted on to bring peace and to save them. And he just asked, "Where is your faith? Why are you so afraid?" And so as we go through life and as we struggle, and as we go through this plan of salvation, there's no need to be afraid. And we're sad at this time right now because our father or friend has passed, but we know where he is, and that brings peace and joy, and there's no reason to be afraid. There's reason to have great joy and great happiness in our life. And this I believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
What a beautiful service. You have honored your father. You've honored his wishes by making this a beautiful service. We're here today. What a great support group of people that were affected by Arlen's life and who he was and who he is. What a great gathering. I testify to you that there is a beautiful gathering that's happening on the other side of the veil. As Arlen is back with family and friends, that gathering is taking place. My remarks today are redirected and very short. As Matt shared his stories and his story about his snowmobile trip as a 10-year-old boy. His dad went back around to check on him and tell him to follow the tracks. I testify that you as family members, as his children, Arlen will be whipping back around to check on you. And he will say, "Just follow the tracks." That's our Savior. He also is checking on us. He is with us. And just telling us, "Follow the tracks." Arlen, you're a good man. We love you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen.
We are so grateful to be able to come together in celebration of the life of our father and grandfather and friend. We are so grateful for the knowledge that we have of the Savior Jesus Christ and his atonement that has given us the wonderful plan that families can be together forever. We are so grateful for the memories that we have had and shared through the life of this man. Bless us now with an added measure of thy Spirit, that we will be able to feel the peace and comfort that comes only from the Savior Jesus Christ. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.